then the equation is actually satisfied. So notice the use of the indices here, x0 and y0. This is a convention that one sometimes does, that we have these general variables x and y, which can be rather general, and when we want to refer to specific values of them, as we do here, then we're putting these indices x0 and y0 there. So these are particular numbers that are going to end up playing the roles of the x and y in this equation. So that's what it means for the point A to lie on the line L. And importantly, we'll also say that the line L passes through the point A. And another way of showing that same relation is that we'll say that A is incident with L. That makes it temporal balanced. The point and the line are incident. Okay, so that's the crucial property that connects points and lines. Although we define lines purely algebraically, of course we want to visualize them as well. So we're going to do that by plotting some of the points that lie on the line on the affine plane. So here is our affine plane, or at least part of it, right? I mean, actually the thing extends, or it could be extended in either direction. But this is just a portion of it that we actually bother to write down. Okay, x-axis here, y-axis here, x-coordinates here, y-coordinates here. Parallel lines, as you can see, equally spaced. Okay, here are two lines. The line L, with equation 3x plus 2y equals 6, that's in red. And the line L, with equation x minus y equals 1, and that's in green. And let's just sort of verify that these lines contain certain points. So, let's have a look at line L. Can we find any points that lie on this line? That means we're looking for here, x and y that satisfy the equation of the line. And that's, of course, reasonably easy to do. We said x equals 0 and y equals 3, and we get a point that satisfies the equation. That's that point right there. If we said y equals 0 and x equals 2, we get the point 2, 0, which is right here, and that also lies on the line. This suggests that perhaps this line L goes through the point 4 minus 3. How do we check whether that's true? We have a look to see whether 4 minus 3 satisfies the equation. And yes, it does. 3 times 4 plus 2 times minus 3 is indeed 6. Yes, this point here will also satisfy the equation. But there are lots of other points that satisfy the equation. In fact, all of the points that you could find that would lie on this line would have that property. So we went around and plotted a lot more points that satisfy this, and we find that they all lie on this line. This really is one of the great insights of Fermat and Descartes in the 17th century. But a linear equation like this, when you actually plot the points, you actually do get a straight line. And crucially, it doesn't depend on having a standard Euclidean framework where you have lots of perpendicular lines that are equally spaced in the x and y direction coordinates. It's true even with these more general types of lines with a general affine plane. How about m equals the line x minus y equals 1? Well, we can find some points on there. The point 1, 0 is on there. 1, 0 satisfies the equation. 0 minus 1 is on there. That's that point there. The point 2, 1 is on there. There it is there. The point 3, 2 is on it. There it is there. How about the points 2 and a half, 1 and a half? 2 and a half, 1 and a half? Okay, let's do 1. That would be 2 and a half there, 1 and a half, that would be there. Okay, so even though we often restrict ourselves to integer values because the arithmetic is either, we should be aware that we're really talking about rational numbers or integer. So there's lots of intermediate points that we can also specify. Okay, and so all of the points obviously line up, of course, extending that direction and extending the utility as well, will satisfy the equation of this line. And conversely, everything that satisfies the equation of the line will actually physically be on this geometrically straight line. So it's a lovely kind of basic fact that linear equations correspond to straight lines in the affine grid plane. So I'm hoping that that's pretty familiar to you. But now we want to up the ante and move to a slightly more sophisticated point of view towards points and lines, which will give us increased power in being able to make calculations. That involves harnessing a projective point of view. And the key technology is contained in this idea of a proportion. And we'll be considering two kinds of proportions. So first of all, a two-proportion is an expression from A to B. So there's a colon here, and we'll say A to B, where A and B are rational numbers, not both zero. One of them can be zero, but not both of them. And we're going to agree that there's an important convention of equality here. Let's give it by this expression here. That A to B is equal to lambda A to lambda B for any non-zero number lambda. In other words, if we take a given proportion and we multiply both of the entries by the same non-zero number, then we get an equal proportion. Okay, we agree that that's what equality is in terms of these proportions. And correspondingly, we're going to go up one to the three proportion to be an expression for A to B to C, where again, A, B, and C are rational numbers, and not all zero. So one of them could be zero, maybe two of them could be zero, but not all three of them, okay? And we have a similar kind of convention that the proportion A to B to C is by definition equal to lambda A to lambda B to lambda C for any non-zero number lambda. These ideas go back to the ancient Greeks, at least, okay? And the ancient Greeks were very conscious of the idea of the relative sizes of two numbers. That's what we're getting at here. That it's not really the absolute value of A or B, but the relative sizes that's captured by the idea of proportion. In a way, it's very similar, kind of parallel to the idea of a fraction. So the proportion A to B acts in a lot of ways like the fraction A over B. But it's crucially different in that we're not insisting that the B be non-zero. If we're working with a fraction a over b, we'd have to insist that the denominator not be zero. Here we're not making that insistence. So such expressions. The AE minus BD should equal 0, the AF minus CD should equal 0, and the BF minus CD should equal 0. And you can think about this as sort of being three of these two proportions put together. So what's contained in this three proportion are really three two proportions. The first one you have ignoring the third element, that's just that. The second one you can ignoring the middle elements, A to C, the same as DF. And the third one ignoring the first elements, B to C equals E to F. So these are just these conditions apply to each one of those separate two proportions, which are contained in the three proportion. And here are some examples. And you can check 6 to 4 is equal to 9 to 6, since 6 times 6 minus 4 times 9 is 0. And here 1 to a half to a third equals 6 to 3 to 2, since 1 times 3 minus a half times 6 is 0. 1 times 2 minus a third times 6 is 0. And 1 half times 2 minus 1 third times 3 equals 0. So we need to check all three of those conditions. If they're satisfied, then these two three proportions are equal.
Minus 2.
2 to 4. Here's another example of line M, which is in the form 5 equals 3 over 2x minus 5. This is not exactly our standard form, the same way we have here. So let's think about how we can rewrite this standard form. Well, we multiply, say, by 2, get rid of that denominator, it'll be 2y equals 3x minus 10. And if we run it into the one side, we get 3x minus 2y minus 10 equals 0. That's right, therefore, we can immediately write down what the projective form of that minus is 3, the coefficient of x, minus 2, the coefficient of y, minus 10, the other number on the same side. So I hope you appreciate that there's something powerful about this point of view. Because when we were talking about equations of lines, it was a little bit ambiguous, right? There were all these different possible ways of rewriting the equation. Maybe with y on the left-hand side, or with x on the left-hand side, or with both of those on the left-hand side. But when we convert into this projective form, then those ambiguities mostly disappear. And the only ambiguity that's left is the fact that we can multiply all three numbers by a scalar, by a non-zero scalar. So conceptually, this is actually a very nice and attractive way of thinking about what points and lines are. We could have started by defining affine points and lines in this way. Think about affine points and lines in this more traditional way, and just think about these being alternate ways of representing them. These are the projective ways of representing points and lines. Okay, so here we come to an important formula called the projective incidence formula. So from my point of view, we are very interested in formulas. This course will be filled with interesting formulas, and we think of formulas as being just as important as they are. And if we can, we want to present information in the form of formulas, feeling more comfortable and confident about validating and interpreting and verifying formulas. Okay, so this is a way of thinking about what the relationship between the point and line is, this incidence relationship, in the language of the projective coordinates. Okay, so the same as that point A, let's say A to B to C, that's the projective form of the point, is incident with the line L, which is R to S to T, so that's the projective form of the line, precisely when this relation is satisfied. When A times R plus B times S plus C times T equals 0. In other words, if we take the definition of incidence that we originally had in the affine case and convert it into this projective setting, then this is the relationship that we end up with. This is the test about whether this point and this line are incident. So for example, we can check that the point 4 minus 3 lies on the line 3x plus 2y equals 6. We can do that directly, just by substituting this in and seeing if it works. 3 times 4 plus 2 times minus 3, yes, that actually equals 6. So yes, this point does lie on this line. But then we can also do this using projective coordinates. Let's see how that would work. So this point would be represented projectively as point 4 minus 3 to 1. That's how we go from a point in affine coordinates to projective coordinates. This line would be represented by projective coordinates 3 to 2 to minus 6. Okay. And then we can check incidence just by applying this rule. 4 times 3 plus minus 3 times 2 plus 1 times minus 6 equals, that's 12, that's minus 6, that's minus 6. So yes, we get 0. We get 0, so yes, this point and this line are incident. That's how we check that relation in the projective coordinates. So to end this lecture, I'm going to show you two very important formulas that allow us to do two important things that we want to do. First of all, to find the join of two points. If two points, how do you find the equation of the line that joins them? And then secondly, how do you find the meet of two lines? And we're going to see that this projective point of view really makes this problem very interesting and attractive. Okay. So the join of the points A and B, and the point A is A to B to C, and the point B is D to E to F. This is the following line, L, which we're going to first of all write as AB. So AB means the line that joins AB. The line that passes through A and B. And here's the final coordinate, projective coordinate-wise. So it's a line, you can see that by the round brackets, that has three entries. And the entries are what? The entries are BF minus CE, that's the first entry. The second entry is CD minus AF. And the third entry is AE minus BD. Now that might look like a rather imposing kind of formula, but I do remind you that those are exactly the kinds of quantities that appear when we were investigating the question of when a three proportion equals another three proportion. So this thing here is just the second and third entries, just the second and third entries here and here. So we just look at B, C, and E, and it's B times F minus C times E. And it's the second entry that involves the first and third entries are both. So it's C times D minus A times F. And the third entry just involves the two first entries, A, B here, and D, E here. It's A times E minus B times D. So, for example, if A is the point 3, 1, then B is the point minus 1, 4. Here's a diagram. There's the point A, 3, 1. There's the point B, which is minus 1, 4. Then we might want to find the equation of the line that passes through. Now, in high school, you may have learned that in order to solve this, you need to solve some system of two linear equations. This is really an alternate and very powerful way of solving this important problem. What we do is we convert the points into projective points. So 3, 1 becomes 3 to 1 to 1, and minus 1, 4 becomes minus 1 to 4 to 1. And then we just apply this formula to write down immediately the projective equation of the line at. passing through those two points. Which is one. Okay, so the first entry is obtained by the second and third entries here. So it's 1 times 1 minus 1 times 4.